A very good morning and a warm welcome to everyone present here. I, Mr. Pushkar Bhojne from the Department of Biotechnology, welcomes everyone to the guest lecture entitled Epifluorescence Microscopy. Before I ask our guest to take over the session, I would like to give her an honorable introduction first. Ms. Komal Khade is currently a project technical officer at ICMR National Institute for Research in Reproductive Health, and at times involved in clinical studies for endometriosis. She has also associated herself with National Institute of Oceanography and taken up several marine projects. She has working experience with instruments like epifluorescence microscopy and thermocyclers. Ms. Komal is also an ex-student of the department, and she is here with us today to share the experiences and her knowledge. I will request all the participants not to interrupt the session and keep their camera and mics switched off. All questions can be typed in the chat box or can be discussed later after the session is completed. I will now request Ms. Komal Khade, ma'am, to take over the session. Thank you, ma'am.
Good morning, everyone. May I know what class is this, sir? Like the year?
Ma'am, there are second year biotechnology and microbiology, as well as MSc 1 microbiology and biotechnology.
Okay. Thank you. So I'll start with sharing my screen. If you can hold on. Is my screen visible?
Yes, ma'am, it is visible.
Hold on. Okay. So,
ma'am, we'll have to make it option as enable editing. It is asking you.
I think are my slides changing?
No, ma'am. You'll have to enable the option as enable editing.
Okay. Hold on. Okay. Anna, are they changing now?
Ma'am, it has actually stopped sharing your screen.
Okay, hold on.
Yes, ma'am. Sure, ma'am.
Is it now visible to all?
Yes, it is visible.
And is it changing?
Ma'am, can you go to the slide share more? So that we will be able to. Yes, it is changing. It is now changing.
Okay, so I'll have to slide show. Is it changing
yes.
Now?
Ma'am. Have you shared a presentation or have you shared your whole screen?
I've shared the screen with me.
Okay, because it is not okay because it is not going into the presentation mode actually.
Okay, so hold on, like,
ma'am, it is fine if we go like this also. It is fine.
Okay.
Yes, ma'am. Sure.
Thank you. So, good morning, everyone. Good morning, ma'am. Good morning. Okay. So, I'll start my lecture with epifluorescence microscopy. Basically, I would like to tell is I'll be more focusing on the practical part. I'll be sure to cover the theoretical part, which is important from the exam point of view, you know, since all of this is for your exam. So, I'll make sure that you understand the theory from the exam point of view so you can write it. But basically, I would tell you like focus more on the practical part, because that would help you further, you know, in research, while designing your own experiment, or like when you are given an experiment, you won't be told ki, you know, do this microscopy. You will have to come up with your own ideas on how you prove your hypothesis or how will you come up with, you know, data presentation? So I would request that while asking, so I'm more focused on the practical aspect, but I'll be sure to cover your theoretical part from your exam point of view. Okay. So starting with, so the introduction of fluorescence. How did this fluorescence idea was observed, or who was the first person to observe this and further then put it into a way that can be used for various scientific and biological analysis? So it was in 1852, an Irish physicist and a mathematician, Sir Gabriel George Stoke, who noted down that while he was having a glass of quinine water, he observed that the sunlight, which was filtering through a purple glass window of his house, was then striking his glass of wine, was showing a blue color fluorescence. It was then, and after several other observations and experiments he did, he observed this phenomena of fluorescence. Now, I would like to focus on this two part, the filtering part, the filtering capacity or the ability of the two glasses that were present at this time, like the purple glass window and the glass of the wine glass, the glass. So it was because of these two glasses were present at the, you know, at were there, he was able to observe this fluorescence. Without the presence of any, even in the absence of any one of the glasses or the passing of direct sunlight through the glass, he wouldn't have been able to observe this fluorescence. Okay, so remember, for the further references, the filtering capacity ability of the two glass. Okay, so that was the first observation in 1852 made by Sir George Gabriel. Okay, so now what is a fluorescence? Fluorescence is the ability of an atom, atomic level I'm talking, it is the ability of an atom to an electron to observe a high energy light which has been incident upon it, to take and absorb this energy and go to a higher state level of energy, that is to an higher orbit. But again, at this higher orbit, this electron is not stable, so it will jump back again to its ground state, giving out the excess energy that it had. So that the energy that it gives out is called as the fluorescence. Okay, so with this basic principle, we have made lot of various biological application with this principle of fluorescence. Okay, so now at the atom level, if you see, incident ray, a high energy wavelength is incident upon the atom. The energy, the electron will take up this energy and then move up on to the excited state. Now, since it is not stable at the excited state, it will go back to its ground state, giving out this energy. Okay. So in fluorescence, a shorter wavelength and high energy wavelength is absorbed, and a longer wavelength of a low energy is given out. This phenomena is also called as Stoke shift, because he was the first person to observe it. It was named after him. Okay, so the absorption of longer, shorter wavelength and high energy wavelength, and emission of a longer wavelength and a lower energy wavelength is called as a Stoke shift. Okay. This phenomena can also be presented by a diagram which is called as Jablonski diagram. If you see here, it is just the orbit of the electron atom and how it go while going back to its ground state, it gives out the energy. So for example point of view, if you draw this diagram, while explaining this, it would be helpful for you as well as for the examiner to understand that you have understood the procedure. Okay, so that was fluorescence. Okay, I hope, actually, since I cannot see you, any of you, I don't know if you're getting it or not. Am I? Is it clear till here?
Yes.
Yeah, okay, thank you. Okay, so I'll move back. So now, microscopy. I think the MSc student might, I think all of you might be knowing now, till now, the basic principle how the microscopy works. Okay, but still I'll just go through, I'll just go through the basic microscopy. So that would help you to recollect and, you know, help you to relate with the further, the fluorescence microscopy. Okay, in basic microscopy, there is a source of light which is reflected onto a mirror, which transmit it to the condenser, which concentrates this light onto your specimen. Further, through the specimen, or after it is onto the specimen then transmit this light onto your objective lenses, where your real image is formed, and from there you observe this image through your eyepiece. So the important part of your microscopes are your light source, your mirror, your condenser, and your lenses. Okay, so this is the basic structure, or you know, the components of your microscopy. Similarly, in the epifluorescence microscopy or the fluorescence microscopy, this basic structure would remain. Only the parts and the name of the parts would change. Okay, now coming to the fluorescence microscopy. Now, what is a fluorescence microscopy, or is it different from epifluorescence microscopy? No. The most simplest form of fluorescence microscopy is called as epifluorescence microscopy. Okay. Then the other type of fluorescence microscopy involves confocal fluorescence microscopy or total internal reflection microscopy. Now, both of them, all of these, they differ in the what light source do they use, what kind of images are produced after processing of, you know, after detection of the lights and everything. They all differ in all these aspects. For example, in confocal microscopy, you get 3D images and the light source that is used is a laser. Okay. Whereas in epifluorescence microscopy, there are other type of white light type of halogen lamp or xenon arc lamp. These kind of light sources are used, and it does not give rise to 3D images. Okay, so that is a difference between a different type of fluorescence microscopy. Okay, since we are going to focus on epifluorescence microscopy, so I'll further take you to what exactly happens in the fluorescence microscopy. Okay, so this is a fluorescence microscope. Okay, this is the commercially available available microscopes which are used in laboratories. Now I will show you like how does the light travels through these the path of light in this microscope and how the image is formed. Okay, so through the light source it goes to the excitation filter. I'll get to the function of each and every component later. I will just go through the light path. Okay, so it goes to the excitation filter. Through the excitation filter, it will go to your specimen. The specimen then gives out the fluorescence. It will then go through the dichroic mirror, through the emission filter, through your and then to your lenses, and to the detector. Now, what is the function of each and every filters? Okay, the light source. Okay, now of course for every microscopy you need a light source. Without it you cannot observe a single thing under this microscope. Okay, so there has to be a light source. Then there is this light source. The light from this light source goes onto the excitation filter. Now, what is an excitation filter? An excitation filter will allow only the passage of that light of a wavelength that can excite the fluorescence molecule which you have used to label your specimen. Okay. So also the excitation filter will allow only that light wavelength of light to pass through your excitation filter. Okay. Then through the excitation filter, your excited light comes to your specimen. It then excites the fluorochrome which you have used to label your specimen. Now the sample preparation and all, I'll come to it. So you have labeled your specimen with a certain fluorochrome dye. Okay, so it will excite this wavelength, will excite that fluorochrome,
now the principle of here, the what the Stokes shift we have talked earlier, that a fluorochrome will absorb this shorter wavelength of high energy and then give out longer wavelength of lower energy. Okay, this there will be a difference between the incident light and the emitted light. Okay, this difference bit of the energy is called the Stokes shift. Now this transmitted light will then go through the dichroic mirror. Now what's a dichroic mirror? It basically act as, you know, a selective passage which will allow only the emitted light to go to your further component of your microscopy. It won't allow this light or any incident stray light to go through this through the further components. Okay, so that is one important job of this responsibility of this dichroic mirror. It won't allow any other lights to pass through this okay. Now further, now what will emission filter do? Again, emission filter will further enhance this, the job of this mirror. It will allow only that light of a wavelength to pass through your filter, this emission filter, which the fluorochrome has given out. No any other light. For example, if you have stained your sample with a dye called as DAPI, this emission light ka wavelength will be around 359 nanometer. When it gives out this fluorescence, the wavelength of this light will be 457 nanometer. So this emission filter will allow only the passing of that wavelength and no other wavelength. Now what will happen if other wavelengths are also pass through this, or even a little bit of incident ray or any other is stray light also pass out, you will end up with a poor quality image. Okay, so these are the basic component of your fluorescence microscopy: your excitation filter, your dichroic mirror, and your emission filter, and of course your light source. Now this entire components, this excitation, dichroic, and emission filter, in this modern or the commercially available microscope, they are situated are packed into one particular box, which is generally known as filter cube. Okay, this is basically called as a filter cube, which is the most essential part of your microscope. This entire thing is put into that particular box, and that's why it is known as the filter cube. Okay, so if you see, I will show you. Okay, this is the transverse section of your fluorescence microscope, which is generally generally used in your laboratories. Your lamp, your source of lamp, that is your source of light. Okay, now here will be your filter cubes, here will be your stage, and this will be your eyepiece through which you will observe your image. Okay, so remember the filter cube, it consists of all these basic part in one particular setup. It's called the filter cube. Now we have seen how the light passes. Through this pathway, what happens? Okay, to epifluorescence microscopy is that the sample has to be excited with specific color of light. Okay, so now if the incident light and the excitation light, I hope you remember the incident light, the one which is filtered through your excitation filter, and the emission light, which is filtered through the emission filter, which is given out by your fluorochrome. If that is not well separated, it will give rise to a low signal to noise ratio, which will reduce your resolution of your images. Okay, so that is one thing. If you use the choices of your filter matters while doing this. So if that is not well separated, the lights are not separated, you won't get a proper image. Okay. Also, the diagram, the field and the aperture diaphragms, that I hope you remember diaphragms. Diaphragms in the normal microscopy are generally situated above your condenser, and they focuses your light, what the amount of light that goes into your which goes onto your specimen, right? So in this in any microscopy, the alignment of this the aperture of diaphragm is very important. Okay, so if it is not if this is not aligned properly, again there is a lot of stray light that will go onto your sample, and again it will decrease your signal to noise ratio. Also, if this is not done, if this is not aligned properly, the, you know, if it is not controlled how much light is going onto your sample, it will lead to something called as photo bleaching, photo bleaching is, it will destroy your sample. So if you destroy your sample, all the fluorochrome as well as your whatever cells are there, because of this high light, high intensity light, it will damage and it will start rupturing. If it's a cell, it will start rupturing and it will be all like, you know, all messy. You won't get a proper image basically, since nothing is now in a proper structure. Your sample is damaged, and also whatever you have used, the filters that have used, that is also damaged. So that is called photo bleaching. Okay, now again, then after it goes to your dichroic mirror. Again, the dichroic mirror has to be situated at 45 degree angle. Okay, if it is not, if again this or this, what is called, this alignment of this is also important. Many a times while using your microscopy or using this, you know, while using microscopy in your lab and all, especially these alignments are very important. If these alignments are get disturbed, now you actually have to call the person, the technical person, and help and ask him to come and help you the align. If you are first time users and have not used it like, you know, like for longer time, and you don't know how to, it takes, if you have to call the technical person and he comes and he helps you in the alignment, and then, you know, you get a proper image. Okay, so that is one thing. So the alignment of all these, you know, the flora, your filters, your diaphragm, your field aperture is very important while observing, then while to get a good quality of image. Okay, so now coming to the fluorescence path. Now, just hold on. Okay, the fluorophores. Now, as we said, there has to be something for the specimen to give up light. Right, not all the the specimens or bacteria can give up light. So either there is something called as autofluorescence and fluorescence. Autofluorescence is when the sample has a ability itself to give fluorescence on receiving an incident light. That is autofluorescence, and very biologically, it is observed. Sometimes it is observed in nature. Okay, but most of the samples that we study we study using this microscope, they have to be stained. Okay, so they have to be stained. So that's when the fluorescence, the fluorophores comes into the picture. Okay, so there are a lot of various other, for every particular, all of these fluorophores, they have their own excitation wavelength and their own emission wavelength. So what happens is, when you're giving, while observing this under the microscope, you have to shift your the filters. So in most of your microscopy, like if you say in your commercial microscopy, there is a tunnel like structure that we I'll show you. See, over here, it is over here that you have which you shift while observing, so that the filters are now shift. So at a time you can change. If you see here, this is the it's like a rotating device which you rotate to change your filters. So at a time you cannot observe two or three dyes at a time. At a time, if you're observing one dye, you take the picture, you observe again. If you have stained the sample with some other fluorochromes and it has some different excitation wavelength, you have to change your this, you have to rotate this disc, and it gives you another filter. So again, this is all is situated here itself, and it's called the filter cube. And again, this, you know, in generally commercially, this does not come with your pre-purchase. It doesn't come. You have to buy it on according to your needs and according to what are the dyes that you will be using in your labs. So accordingly, you have to find, you know, I have to ask for the filters. The default filters that comes with it are DAPI, FITZY. These are certain dyes that are used. So these are some default filters that are used that comes up with the original instrument for observation. Other than if you have some other special need, you have to let the person know, and the you know the and accordingly they get you the they fit the filters here. So that is one thing in the commercially available filters. Okay, moving on. So now, what are the different type of light sources that are used in your fluorescence microscopy? One is the tungsten halogen lamp. It has, it's a light source. It's not that great. It's not that bad, but it will do your work. Okay, it has a power of 50 to 100 volt. The intensity of this lamp can be controlled by applying varying voltage. Even though it is used for bright field application, your bright field microscopy, it can be used for fluorescence microscope. Again, they are very inexpensive and they are long lasting. Again, also the phototoxicity that we talked about right now, that photo bleaching, that it won't damage your sample to that extent as the other light source will. One drawback of this tungsten halogen lamp is that there is no UV component to this light source. There is no irradiation of UV light. So your low fluorescence molecule such as cyan fluorescent protein, and if you have stained your sample with this protein and your light source is a tungsten halogen lamp, you won't be able to observe the fluorescence given by this protein because there is no UV component to this tungsten halogen lamp. Okay, so those are some of the drawbacks and the pros and cons of using a tungsten halogen lamp. Then there is something. Second is a mercury arc lamp. Okay, these are the most commonly used, but they are very expensive and they have a time limitation. They will light up only for 200 hours, and as they age, the time decreases, their brightness over the time also decreases. Again, they have to be disposed properly because it's a mercury. And again, therefore, since as your time passes, at it is attaining its complete duration, like it is 190 hours, it has been used for 190 hours, more than 100 hours, 150 hours, the uniformity of, there is no proper illumination in the observed, in the image, in the microscopy, and the images are not that good as they were when it was first when you first switched on your microscope at 0 hours or 1 hour or two after 2 hours. So that has to be corrected with the quantitative various softwares that are available in the market. Okay, the second is a xenon arc lamp. Again, it has a wider range. You can observe fluorescence in visible spectrum and in infrared wavelength as a wavelength, which is not possible here with your mercury and xenon lamp. It is not intense as mercury lamp. Again, it is expensive and again have a shorter period of lifetime, and its brightness decays over the time. Okay, so these are the some of the metal. Then another one is metal halide lamps. They cover broader range of your light spectrum, and they last much more longer than your other two lamps. That is the mercury and the xenon, and the first one was a halogen tungsten lamp. So they metal halides overcome the range limitation of your other two lamps, and again they long last for 10 times longer than other two lamps. Then the most commonly used in your modern these days, all your microscope, they come with light emitting diodes, LEDs, what you call as LEDs. These LEDs at a time, they do not require, again, the one of the important advantage of LEDs, use of LEDs, is the excitation filter is not required. You can use multiple dye at a time, and you just, the switching, the, like I said, when you are using multiple dyes, you have to change your filters, right? In LEDs, that is not needed. Since there are no excitation filters only, you just have to turn and off the required LED. The light of LED of a particular wavelength, of a particular light, of a color, so as to excite your fluorochromes, which you have stained, which you have used in your specimen. So it takes within a millisecond, so that does not also damage your, what you say, sample. It takes milliseconds, you can say it's a real-time image. Again, there is no need for mechanical shutter of the lamp. Again, the LED lifetime is like 10,000 hours. I think it is very much, good than your other four lamps that we have seen. And the most important part is they do not produce heat. What happens is, with all these other lamps, if you use these, mercury lamp, I have worked on a fluorescent which used to use a mercury lamp. So what used to happen is, if you use it for a prolonged time, or if you are, using it for a very long time, this box, it heats up very, for a very, very, like, at a very high temperature. So when, after you have done, you're finishing up your work, you have to switch, you have to let your, the lab, which it is, where the microscope is kept, you have to let it cool down. You actually have to let it cool down, because if you don't, it will damage the quality of your light and the hours, the lifetime of your lamp. What happens is also, it actually heats it to a level where if you touch it, it will be like, sometimes it will give you like a small, that great one, but burn, but you will feel it. It's really hot. I remember one of my dissertation student had actually used this lamp, used the fluorescence microscopy, and generally we cover a microscope, right, with the plastic that thick Olympus, that microscope covering it comes, right? So they forgot to let it cool down, and just immediately they, covered the microscope and everything. And after some time, it was just, I just went to look at the microscope. The plastic was actually completely burned where it touched the mercury lamp. That is one thing. So with these other lamps or the LEDs, LED lights will not produce heat, and they generate, and they have a longer lifeline. Okay. So coming to the fluorescence, the dyes that we use to give up the fluorescence. As I said, there is autofluorescence, certain biological compound may have, but mostly when we study on them, they do not have. We have to actually stain them. So what are fluorochrome, fluorophores, or fluorochromes? They are typically a chemical compound that contains an aromatic group or a plain or cyclic molecules with several pi bonds. They have been designed for a range of biological molecules. Okay, now I would say the most commonly used dyes are DAPI and HOIST. Okay, what DAPI is, DAPI does? It is a nucleic acid stain. It will go and bind to the AT-rich region of the DNA. Okay, that is how it will stain your nucleus. It basically stains your nucleus or the DNA. If it's a bacterial cell, it will be all over. It will stain your DNA. If you're watching a eukaryotic cell, it will mostly give you a nucleus-like appearance when you're observing. If you see your small. And HOIST. HOIST is also a nucleic acid stain. Then another stain, which is called as phthalodiene. It is used to stain actin fibers. If you see here. Actin fibers in your mammalian cell. So at a time, all these images that you're seeing while you're actually observing in microscope, they don't look like this. It is, the ability of the state of art technology or the software that are developed, which gives you, these beautiful images. At a time, for example, like I said, most of the detectors, like coming to that, the detectors that are used in your fluorescence microscopy are monochrome cameras. So at a time, you cannot detect more than two dyes at a time. So what it does, it takes a picture with one dye, another picture with second dye, third dye. If you have stained your your specimen with more than one dye. So you have to take a different picture, and with the help of the software, the pictures are combined to give you multiple color images. Like you can see here, you can see a red color, you can see blue color, you can see green color. That is because it is after the, you know, combining those images. That is, so actually observing under the microscope, it kind of, you know, it's a black, you will see fluorescence, but not that way in which you can see in your images that are developed after processing. Okay. So coming to the application of fluorescence microscopy, one of the most important application of fluorescence microscopy is immunology. What we do in ELISA, we have a primary antibody, we have a secondary antibody which has it has an enzyme. You put your substrate and gives up light, right? Similarly, in this fluorescence, immunofluorescence microscopy, what you do is you have your antibody, your cell. Now, if your example, if you're you're staining a particular microbial cell and you want to study a particular protein. So what will you do is you will make an antibody which is specific to that protein. It will go and bind to that protein. And to that antibody, a fluorochrome is attached. So now when you are observing, give your excitation light and observe, and then further what it goes, the emission light comes out, and you will see the localization of that protein. If you're studying a particular in a particular cell, that is immunofluorescence. When you use an antibody which is attached to your fluorochrome, so that is your immunofluorescence. Like you see here, your antigen, the epitope to which your primary antibody will bind, it will give up your fluorochrome. It has a fluorochrome, then there is a second, so that is the and on your excitation to this fluorochrome, it will give you fluorescence, since it will be called as immunofluorescence because you are using antibodies and all antigen antibody interaction to observe that fluorescence. In secondary immunofluorescence, you will observe. You will use two antibodies, a primary antibody and a secondary antibody. This is just to increase your specificity. So if you see the wide range of proteins or various cell components that you can observe using fluorescence microscopy depends on the various types of fluorochrome are the antibodies that you can generate against your antigen of interest in a particular cell. So I think you can do that, and with that you can observe like lot of other cell components in your cell using antigen antibody reaction, and of course the antibodies has to be stained by a fluorochrome. Okay, so that is immunofluorescence. Further, what other things you can observe is conducting viability studies on a cell population, imaging a structural component of a small cell like specimen, the detection and localization of a particular protein under study. If you want to see when a particular protein is produced and how, where the localization of the protein is happening, you have to stain that protein with the fluorochrome, and you can observe it under your under your epifluorescence microscopy. Again, localization of protein in the cell and tissue. Now coming to the viability part, how will you detect the viability of the protein? This is one experiment that I used to do. In a particular sample, I was supposed to give a report on what is the total viable count of the cell and total bacterial count of the cell and what is the total viable count of the cell. Now, if you know the difference between two, viable count will only include the cells which are viable, whereas the total bacterial count will include what a viable as well as a number of non-viable cells. So how I used to detect it was, I'll show you the sample prep. I couldn't find my picture of doing that, of the instrumentation. So I just got this picture from the Google. So this is your normal vacuum a vacuum filtration, which is available, which you all have seen, I think. what I used to do is there used to be I used to take my sample for total viable count. Generally, plating on your media, on your, you know, on viables, marine agar would be feasible. You used to do that and used to give a total viable count. Only the viable organism will grow into the colony and will give you cell count, so that you can calculate by CFU per ml, by, you know, multiplying it with the dilution factor and everything. That will give you total viable count. So that is viable count. Now, how to know a total bacterial count? So to do a bacterial count, what I used to do is, this is the upper part of your filter. This is where the filter, which I used to use a carbon black filter, which used to be kept here. I used to filter my sample. That is the water sample, 1 liter of water sample through here. After, and through the vacuum, the, you know, all the rest of the water used to get collected here. And now the filter has a lot of, cell, maybe sand. Since it was a marine water sample, so there might be sand or particles or little bit of whatever it is to be stuck inside. So again, to give it a wash, I used to put a PBS, little bit of PBS and everything to give a wash. Okay. And this all used to be in the dark setting. This all has to be done in a dark setting. Then, Now you just cannot just observe it, right? Now the dye has to be added. To do a viable count, to do a bacterial count, you have to add I used to add DAPI stain. Now DAPI used to stain the nucleic acid. Whether the cell is right now viable or non-viable, it's DNA or it has not completely ruptured, right? It still has its DNA are still present, right? So it used to stain that nucleic acid. And while observing under the microscope, you used to get this.
Hello, Komal ma'am. Sorry to interrupt, but your voice is low.
Okay. Is it now?
Yes, it is now fine.
Okay. Was it before this also like this? I hope they all...
No. Just now. Like few seconds back.
Okay, fine. So now, since the bacteria also, you have to let it incubate it for a period of time. Okay, you just can't just filter and observe it directly. You have to let the dye permeabilize the cell. It has to let it take up a dye, incubate it for a few time. Then you remove the setup, you take the filter out, you put it on the glass slide, and under oil immersion, I used to observe this cells. Okay, so this is one of the application that I used to do. Another application that I had used in my previous study was using it for detection of, again, viable count on an LDPE film, when I used to study degradation of a plastic film using the marine bacteria. Plastic, degradation of plastic is a very hot topic these days, and use of biological microorganism is one of the important right now looked up method for tackling this problem. So I did it on a very pilot scale, like very very pilot scale study. So that's how, like, I used to stain that plastic film which I had incubated in a concoction of a microorganism which I had isolated from marine. And after, I used to remove it from every 10 days. I used to stain that plastic film with the DAPI and then observe it under the microscope, DAPI filter. And then I used to observe them under. You can see these small dot, these are actually your microorganism. Okay, so that is because it is total viable. Again, this is again total bacterial count. Again, I don't know whether these organisms are viable right now or not. This is a total bacterial count, because DAPI is staining DNA, AT-rich region of the DNA, irrespective of whether the cell is live or dead. Okay, so that is one application of your that I used to do, and that is fluorescence microscopy for me. If you guys have questions or anything. I hope you have understood. Anything you wanted to get back again, I can do that.
Thank you, ma'am. It was such an informative session. And gave us a deep insight about the epifluorescence microscopy. Ma'am, now with your permission, shall we proceed ahead with question answer session?
Yeah, sure. Again, just one
students.
The detector part, mostly the detectors using this are your CCD cameras. So basically, as I'm going to set.
Komal ma'am, we are not able to hear you due to some background noise, I guess.
Is it now? Can you?
Yes, it is. Yes.
I shouldn't disturb my earphones, okay? So you're basically, your detectors are mostly your cameras, your CCD cameras. So at a time, whatever the image that is observed in your cameras, it has to be processed before you can actually, analyze anything or you can see anything. So that is your detectors. Again, the sample processing is the important part. One part of the sample processing is your incubation time, which you have to give it to your sample and the dye to bind. That is one important thing. If you just immediately observe, you might not get a proper fluorescence or incorrect results, because the fluorescent molecules are anyways in the sample and they will give you results. That one you has to do, and washing of the sample to get rid of the excess dye. So that is one important part of your sample of preparation that you have to do. And there are n number of fluorescent molecule other than just two, but these two are widely used in our biological, biological sampling and biological analysis, your DAPI and your OIS. So that is one thing. And there is something called green fluorescence protein. Again, one of the important this was this paper I read. I'll just tell you about it. So what they did, they had to study a recombinant protein. So what they did, they started making this protein, they added a GFP tag to that protein already. So when the protein was expressed, when this recombinant protein is expressed in the cell, it is already giving you GFP. So now that already has the GFP sequence, GFP gene, green fluorescent protein ka gene with that entire rest of the protein. So now when you will observe it under the the protein or your recombination has taken successfully or not, you just have to observe it under the microscope, and it will give out the fluorescence after putting on the incident rays, and you can see the protein has been expressed. Also then you can see the localization of the protein, because the protein has been now tagged with GFP. So that is one of the interesting I saw in one of the papers. So which is an interesting application of the fluorescence microscopy. So yeah. So,
thank you, ma'am, for this informative session. Participants, I request you to pose the questions in the chat box. Ma'am, there is one question from Aksa. Can we use fluorescent microscopy to detect motility?
Yeah, of course you can. You have to find the right amount of the protein. First of all, you have to see what protein you are targeting. Okay, that is important. You can observe mobility using your fluorescent epifluorescence microscopy. Your choice of your drug and your protein, which is to be studied,
Other question is from Manasi. Are there any other fluorochrome who can only dye viable cells?
Ma'am, your voice is not audible.
Right now?
Yes, it is audible now.
There could be fluorochromes that can dye only viable cells. I just gave you an example of DAPI. It is a nucleic acid stain. Again, if there is something important component of cell which only stain when they are doing viable activity, when they are viable, such as proteins which are expressed only when they are viable, and the dye stains it, or an antibody which is labeled with that dye stains that protein which is expressed only during your viable period of your cell, you can see only viable cells.
Any other question, participants? Any question, please post it in the chat box. There are no more questions, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am, for answering of our participants. Before we end the session, the feedback link will be posted in the chat box and the participants are requested to fill the feedback form. As we end the session, I would like to thank Dr. Mara Kharkar, CEO, and Dr. Srikant Savan, Principal, Patkar Verde College for their support. I also thank our Chief Coordinator, Mrs. Ruchita Dalvi, and Co-Coordinator, Mrs. Anupama Tomar and Mrs. Neha Kodakko, as well as my colleagues for their constant support. I wholeheartedly thank to Ms. Komal S. Khari for enlightening us with the applications of epiphoresis microscopy, as well as taking out time from our busy schedule. Lastly, a big thank you to all the participants for participating in this session. Thank you. Feedback link will be posted. Just be there, students. Just be there, participants.
Study material like the regarding epiphoresis, I can send it to Neha ma'am if it's for fine if you guys need it.
Yes, participants, kindly fill the feedback form. I have posted the link in the chat box.